Good morning. It's great to gather with you all on Pentecost Sunday in this church year. The colors on the pyramids are red, and some other people found red to wear. There's some special decorations and a special cakes and wonderful things to share in the dining room after worship. Special invitation. Come down to the dining room, please, to share in all the wonderful event of this whole Pentecost celebration. It is wonderful to be together. We have several things getting started this week. Summer is not a time off for our church. Summer seems to be wonderful new kinds of busyness. We have Vacation Bible School that will run from Sunday through Thursday. That begins this evening at what time? I'm going to get this right. 5:30. I'm sure there will be some people here preparing hours before that or so on. The theme, maybe you saw the decorated items as you came in, is monumental, taking on some of the decorative aspects of Monument Valley in California and some of the animals from that valley. You'll see posters depicting some of those qualities of God with the animals on as you descend the staircase down to the basement, and they're going to be sharing some great Bible stories this week with the children as we teach them about the greatness of God, illustrated through some of those visual images of Monument Valley in California. That's such a great place to see and look at. Also, tomorrow, Monday, begins the summer lunch program, Monday through Friday, and that is a wonderful thing we are able to share with our community and the surrounding area, inviting people to come 11:30 to 12:30, Monday through Friday, to have a lunch, whatever age, no requirements, no checking, just it's a social time, it's a time for getting a good meal. It's great to have an opportunity to share together. It's a great way for our congregation to extend outreach to our community. There are a bunch of other things going on here. The steak fry at the end of the week, on Friday, that'll be a wonderful event as well. The Properties Committee is using that as a fundraiser, as they often have in the past, every year, for years and years, and they'll be cooking up over 200 steaks that night and sharing them for $20 a ticket. And I believe Amy, our secretary, Amy Herzog, has the tickets in hand. If you didn't get one before worship and want to get one before you leave today, see Amy after worship is over. All right, several other great announcements are here in the bulletin. It's good to see you all here this morning. It's really good to see you all here. Are there any other announcements I may have missed, not having heard what needed all to be shared today? No? Okay. So if you're able, I invite you to stand. If you need to be seated, that's okay. Peace of the Lord be with you always. May we greet each other in God's peace. Let us pray. O Lord, as you guide the psalmist to write his praises to you, we join together and say, O Lord, how many and great are your works and creations in this world. In your wisdom, Lord, you have made them all, and the earth is full of your creation, from creatures in the sea to the land and the mountains, O Lord, all things living, both large and small. All creatures look to you, and you provide for them, and when you give it to them, they receive it. With your hand, Lord, you satisfy the world and all your creation with good things. O Lord, when your face is hidden from us, we are terrified. And when you take away their breath, they die and return to dust. And when you send your spirit, they are created, and you renew the face of the earth. O Lord, we give you glory. O Lord, you endure forever. O Lord, may we always rejoice in your great creation and in your work among us. Let your work be through us as well. All this we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Go ahead and be seated. I'm just hoping, maybe, I do have a few here for children's message. Come down front. Now they will come? Oh, come on. It's going to be amazing. What do you think that is going to be? So, because of the circumstances, you two share a birthday. You do. So, what day of the year is your shared birthday?
May 29th?
We just missed it. It was a few days ago. How many years old were you? You're out of town with mom and dad. Relatives? Fun things?
Nice.
How old are you now?
Seven.
Well, today is a different kind of birthday celebration. This is a birthday celebration for all Christians all over the world. We call it the birthday of the church. We call this special day Pentecost. Jewish celebration of Pentecost. The believers in Jesus were just a few, and they were gathered in one room. You're going to hear the reader read about this soon. In the next Bible reading, he's going to read about this day of Pentecost. And they were gathered in this room, and all of a sudden, something amazing happened. They heard like a loud wind, but it didn't even blow their hair. Then, fire everywhere above them. And then they could speak about Jesus to all kinds of people in all their own languages. That's pretty amazing. We call that the birthday of the church because they were finally able to share about Jesus to so many people, and so many more people became believers in Jesus on that day and every day since then. Even today, there will be new believers in Jesus today. So we call this the birthday of the church, Pentecost. So, I figure we should sing a birthday song, don't you? Light some candles, light some cake, and sing a birthday song. We have to learn it. It's got slightly different words. Happy birthday to the church. Happy birthday to the church. Happy birthday, dear Christians. Happy birthday to the church. Do you think they'll help us sing? Let's light the candles first. If I can get the candles lit. Okay, come on.
Lighter.
Yay, my lighter worked.
Oh, we got some candles blowing, different fire
from the wax,
burning. That's pretty neat, isn't it? Yeah, we got more candles. See all the other candles we have? That flame there reminds us about how fire filled the room. And they were lit on fire, so to speak. Not really, they didn't burn up. But they had a lot of excitement, like get with candles and birthday cakes, right? So, you think they'll help us sing the happy birthday song to the church? Will you help us sing?
Okay. thank you, Holy Spirit, for coming
and helping us believe. Keep working in us.
Amen. I don't know.
Since it was your birthday just last
week. Oh, wonderful.
Our first reading this morning is from the book of Genesis, chapter 11, verses 1 through 9. Now the whole world had one language with a common speech. As people moved eastward, they found a plain in Shinar and settled there. They said to each other, "Come, let's make bricks and bake them thoroughly." They used brick instead of stone and tar for mortar. Then they said, "Come, let us build ourselves a city with a tower that reaches to the heavens so that we may make a name for ourselves. Otherwise, we will be scattered over the face of the whole earth." But the Lord came down to see the city and the tower the people were building. The Lord said, "If as one people speaking the same language, they have begun to do this, then nothing they plan to do will be impossible for them. Come, let us go down and confuse their language, so they will not understand each other." So the Lord scattered them from there all over the earth, and they stopped building the city. That is why it was called Babel, because there the Lord confused the language of the whole world. From there, the Lord scattered them all over the face of the whole earth. Today's psalm is 132, and we will read, 143, and we will read that responsively. Lord, hear my prayer. Listen to my cry for mercy. In your faithfulness and righteousness, come to my relief. The enemy pursues me. He crushes me to the ground. He makes me dwell in the darkness like those long dead.
So my spirit grows faint within me. My heart within me is dismayed.
I remember the days of long ago. I meditate on all your works and consider what your hands have done. Answer me quickly, Lord. My spirit fails. Do not hide your face from me, or I will be like those who go down to the pit.
Let the morning bring me word of your unfailing love, for I have put my trust in you. Show me the way I should go, for to you I have trusted life.
Rescue me from my enemies, Lord, for I hide myself in you. For your name's sake, Lord, preserve my life. In your righteousness, bring me out of trouble. Our second reading is from the book of Acts, chapter 2, verses 1 through 21. When the day of Pentecost came, they were all together in one place. Suddenly, a sound like the blowing of a violent wind came from heaven and filled the whole house where they were sitting. They saw what seemed to be tongues of fire that separated and came to rest on each of them. All of them were filled with the Holy Spirit and began to speak in other tongues as the Spirit enabled them. Now there were staying in Jerusalem God-fearing Jews from every nation under heaven. When they heard this sound, a crowd came together in bewilderment because each one heard their own language being spoken. Utterly amazed, they asked, "Aren't all these who are speaking Galileans? Then how is it that each of us hears them in our native language? Parthians, Medes, Elamites, residents of Mesopotamia, Judea, Cappadocia, Pontus, Asia, Phrygia, Pamphylia, Egypt, and the parts of Libya near Cyrene, visitors from Rome, both Jews and converts to Judaism, Cretans and Arabs. We hear them declare the wonders of the God in our own tongues." Amazed and perplexed, they ask one another, "What does this mean?" Some, however, made fun of them and said, "They have had too much wine." Then Peter stood up with the 11, raised his voice, and addressed the crowd. "Fellow Jews, and all of you who live in Jerusalem, let me explain this to you. Listen carefully to what I say. These people are not drunk, as you suppose. It's only 9 in the morning. Now this is what was spoken by the prophet Joel. In the last days, God says, I will pour out my spirit on all people. Your sons and daughters will prophesy. Your young men will see visions. Your old men will dream dreams. Even on my servants, both men and women, I will pour out my spirit in those days, and they will prophesy. I will show wonders in the heavens above and signs on the earth below, blood and fire and billows of smoke. The sun will be turned to darkness and the moon to blood before the coming of the great and the glorious day of the Lord, and everyone who calls on the name of the Lord will be saved."
Jesus replied, "Anyone who loves me will obey my teaching. My Father will love them and will come to them and make our home with them. Anyone who does not love me will not obey my teaching. These words you hear are not my own. They belong to the Father who sent me. All this I have spoken while still with you. But the Advocate, the Holy Spirit, whom the Father will send in my name, will teach you all things and will remind you of everything I've said to you. Peace I leave with you. My peace I give to you. I do not give to you as the world gives. Do not let your hearts be troubled, and do not be afraid. You heard me say, I'm going away and I'm coming back to you. If you loved me, you would be glad that I'm going to the Father, for the Father is greater than I. I have told you now before it happens, so that when it does happen, you will believe. I will not say much more to you, for the prince of this world is coming. He has no hold over me, but he comes so that the world may learn that I love the Father and do exactly what my Father has commanded me. Come now, let us leave." Gospel of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
You may go ahead and be seated. Sort of the pre-sermon before the sermon, just an explanation here. The Genesis reading, which talks about this great tower being built, was a prideful moment of those people. And then God humbled them, confused them by giving them all different languages that they couldn't understand each other. So from pride, they were humbled. And then we have
in Acts chapter 2, where the Holy Spirit comes, and now all of a sudden, many languages are being spoken, and the Holy Spirit is allowing them to do this. God is giving them the ability to do this, not for pride, but that the word about Jesus could be shared. The good news of Jesus could be shared. So that's the kind of the background of Pentecost and the Holy Spirit. They were confused. They were humbled because they were doing so well, they thought, building their own monuments to themselves on their own prideful things. But then God humbled them. But then God came back to them with the Holy Spirit later after Jesus has ascended into heaven and gives them a great gift. So that's kind of background information that leads us into what Jesus spoke to them about in John chapter 14. So we have John chapter 14, and just thinking, since that Pentecost event, there have been so many blessings, so many various ways. But most of all, I think we're blessed because we have salvation through the work of Jesus Christ on the cross for us. We are blessed to experience the forgiveness of sins. We are blessed to receive grace through and in and even underneath somehow the bread and the wine of Holy Communion. God gives us His grace. We're blessed also with the gift of Sabbath. Sabbath to rest, to share, to glorify the Lord, humbling ourselves, receiving the rest that He gives to us. We're blessed with the gift of life and respect for life. We're blessed with the gift of marriage and a family. We're blessed with abilities in making a living and in the volunteer work that we do for others that is not for a salary or a paycheck. We're blessed with neighbors and people and family to care for and those who care for us. There are numerous ways in which we are blessed with relationships and things. So many blessings. And yet, as I think about the blessings, I'm also mindful of the many ways that people struggle, of the many ways in which there are difficulties in life, of the sufferings that happen, the particular situations that people go through, that are going through this week, last week, the week before, and will happen in the future. Frustrating, difficult, depressing. Doesn't matter if we are people of Christian faith and believers in Jesus. Illnesses, accidents, life's disappointments, life's tragedies can't be avoided. God doesn't promise that if we believe enough, suddenly we'll be without any of those, that we'll be carefree living and worry-free life. That is not promised to us as Christian believers. Sufferings, frustrations in our lives are not some kind of illness that we suddenly can get over with and be cured of, but those sufferings and frustrations and difficulties and depressing moments are always present, aren't they? They are. Some people readily let us know when they're hurting, and other people shy away from letting others know and asking for help. Some people are somehow emboldened to ask for help, to say, pray for me, or pray with me, or come help me. They're emboldened to cry out in the misery that they are suffering. And those who cry out in misery are as old as all of human history, aren't they? And even as fresh as this week's headlines, tomorrow's TV news coverage. Thinking about the miseries of the world made me think of and go back in my mind, in which I see somehow those miseries sometimes communicated to us in various different ways, in artistic ways that help us to think and process and become more compassionate people. And one of the ways that I've experienced that in my life is through the artistic thing of what is called a musical. I first became exposed to musicals as a small child in my hometown of Manson, as I watched a musical first called South Pacific. I don't know if I was six. Another musical I remember from my childhood was Oliver. Oliver showed me whole group of people that didn't have much. And then in my adult life, I got exposed to a musical called Les Miserables, or usually known just as Les Mis. Les Mis was based on a novel by a French author named Victor Hugo, and the author brings us to the streets of Paris in the 1830s in France, and then the author's story from the book is retold in this musical. The musical surrounds the story of a man named Jean Valjean. You don't need to remember his name, but just know that this man was arrested in prison for stealing a loaf of bread to feed his sister and her child. Other important characters in the story are a policeman named Javert and a woman named Fantine and her daughter Cosette. And the story unfolds at a time when the French government did not show mercy to the underclass people except for one general named Lamarck. And yet as this story unfolds, Lamarck is dying. And so the people are losing hope. The average people of Paris, there is really no middle class. There are those that have much, the wealthy, and then there are all the other people, the lowest class of people. They are the have-nots. And these ones in misery are crying out. Will people notice them? And who notices them? The university students notice them. They are filled with compassion for the poor ones, and with their idealism in the musical, a small group of students gather and they sing a song, of which I'll sing one little verse for you, and the words are going to be up on the screen here. And they sing, "Look down and see the beggars at your feet. Look down and show some mercy if you can. Look down and see the sweepings of the street. Look down upon your fellow man." They wanted people to notice, to see those who are suffering. What images fill your mind as you hear those words? Current images, I would think. The ones that are in suffering and misery. The suffering refugees from Ukraine, as in that top picture there, as they were running off away from cities that were being bombed and shelled and invaded, trying to get away to safety, the women and the children going, and the men that were of fighting age staying behind. They drove cars, they rode trains, they tried to escape. And what was left at home are bombed out apartment buildings, bombed out schools, bombed out factories, and the war crimes that are shown to us in the TV news. Or how about the starving refugees at a camp in Ethiopia? Or migrant workers on their knees and hands in California and Arizona harvesting strawberries that we might enjoy them? Or the homeless that we can see in Fort Dodge, Des Moines, anywhere around the country, in bigger cities, as we see them wandering with bags and carts, lining up to get a meal, maybe trying to get shelter in the coldest nights of the year. Maybe you know suffering ones, like a neighbor who's overcome by alcoholism, or children abused, or women abused, or men abused. There are suffering people all around us, and some of them are us. Today, tomorrow it might be a new set of people. In the musical Les Mis, the student revolutionaries hear the cry of the miserable ones. They have idealism and hope, and they want to help. And with passion, they are drawn into this conflict between the wealthy and rich aristocracy and the common citizens that are so poor that have barely enough bread to eat. And the students swing into action. They make plans and they put their lives on the line for people. In the midst of suffering and starving and exploitation, the students sing a song that is a word of hope. You might remember a scene from the musical if you've ever seen it before, the barricade, and the students standing there brandishing weapons against the whole French army. "Do you hear the people say, suffering in the musical now to this idea that there are those who are suffering in this world today, and the flame of Pentecost never dies. What an image, what a vision for us. The flame of God's Pentecost never dies. On that great day in history in Jerusalem, 2,000 years ago, God sent the Advocate, our Helper. The Holy Spirit calls us and attracts us to a loving and faithful God who promises never to leave us, never to forget us. The Holy Spirit is gathering us into a community of believers, and not just 60 of us here at Badger today, but those that are not here today, but those that are in Humboldt and Thor, and those who are in Fort Dodge and Des Moines and Atlanta and Los Angeles and California, and those who are in China, and those who are in remote villages and big cities in Africa, and those that are in South America, all gathering around and praising the name of Jesus, and the Holy Spirit working in them and through them. They're gathered together as the community. As I shared with the children, this is the birthday of the church. The Holy Spirit is here to help us to become educated in God's truth and motivating and strengthening us to do God's will. These two verses out of today's gospel reading, I really want you to hone in on. Chapter 14 of John's gospel is where we're at. This is good news for those who are suffering and feeling miserable. This is good news for those who are ministering to those who are suffering. Verse 26 and 27, right here for you to see. But the Advocate, the Holy Spirit, whom the Father will send in my name, that's the Holy Spirit that is talked about, of course, will teach you all things and will remind you of everything I've said to you. That is part of the work of the Holy Spirit. Sometimes we think the work of the Holy Spirit is kind of get us fired up, get us excited. But the Holy Spirit's work is a teaching work, a reminding you work of the things that you've been learning all throughout your life, from childhood now into adulthood. And then verse 27. Also the Holy Spirit's work, peace. Peace. Peace I leave with you, my peace I give to you. I do not give to you as the world gives. Do not let your hearts be troubled. Do not be afraid. We absolutely need to hear that, don't we? Do not let your hearts be troubled. Do not be afraid. There are a whole lot of things in our lives and a whole lot of things going around in this world that can fill us with fear, fill us with troubled hearts. So we need to constantly be reminded of these truths of God's word, constantly be reminded of the truths of Jesus, that we are so loved that the Son of God has come to us. We are truly blessed, washed in the baptismal waters, cleansed by the forgiving blood of Jesus. Lives. Your lives. Christians' lives around this world are not easy lives. Never promised to us to be easy. But unfortunately, you will hear some false preachers out there that promise that if you just believe enough, your life will be good. You will have success. And of course, if you don't have enough success, it's because you're somehow lacking in your belief and faith. Just making you feel guilty and worse than you already were before. Well, that's false preaching. That's lies. What is the truth? My peace I leave for you. My peace for you, God says. God's peace for you. God's love for you. It's effective and it works in your hearts all the way through times of suffering and struggles. Maybe today's a good day. Maybe you are not feeling like you are struggling today, but there are ones around you that are. And maybe your day is coming, I don't know. But we know that life is a mixture of both good and bad. And we celebrate the good, and we sometimes grumble with the bad. But the flame of God's Holy Spirit, that flame that became distributed to all believers, first in baptism, but then God turns up that flame more as our hearts and minds embrace the truth of the Lord Jesus Christ and His saving grace, saved by this sacrifice of Jesus for us, and that flame gets even higher in us as we submit our lives to God's purposes. We have these gifts and abilities, the individual, unique talents, and God, the Holy Spirit, can work in each and every one of us to unleash these talents so that we might do simple acts of service and care and love for each other. God, the Holy Spirit, is our helper, our counselor, our advocate, and the promise is that God, the Holy Spirit, makes more out of our efforts, imperfect as they are. We can love and care for others as we are called by God to do so. So who else, if not you, is going to reach out to your neighbors? Christian life is not about a good word from God that just eases our conscience and gives us a promise of eternal life. That's not only what it's about. I mean, we want to know John 3:16, that God so loved the world that he gave his one and only Son, that everyone who believes in him would not perish but have eternal life. We want to know that as one of the truths. But that's not the only part of Christian life. That's like the basic piece, a foundational stone that we build upon and grow with. A Christian life is all that and so much more, isn't it? We are called by the Holy Spirit's work in us to get beyond individualism. We are called to move with God's freedom in us to go outside of our homes and get to know our neighbors. Maybe some of you read that article I wrote in the newsletter. We are called to a freedom that loves and honors the Word of God and God's Word in its entirety. And its will, God's will is shared and communicated to us. We are called to share the lives of our fellow strugglers within our Christian family, within our community, around our world. Tragedies, the heartaches are not meant to be gone through alone. You are not meant to suffer alone. Share it with somebody. We are a Christian family together. And when one is hurting, all of us should feel it in some way or another. And show our love back to them in many ways. Do not let your hearts be troubled, neither let them be afraid. That is God's word for you, and that's a calling and a privilege empowered by the Holy Spirit, the Spirit of truth. God's Spirit knows you and lives in you. This flame of Pentecost never dies. This is the true peace of the Lord. And maybe you can hear this truth and the echoes, even through something as secular as a musical lyric. Hope for those who are struggling. Hope for those who are suffering. Realize that the flame that I'm singing about is not just a candle. Do you hear the people sing, lost in the valley of the night? It is the music of the people who are climbing to the light. For the wretched of the earth, there is a flame that never dies. Even the darkest night will end and the sun will rise. And to that, all God's people can say, amen. Amen.
I invite you to stand.
Thank you.
but the truths of
God's word, God's authority in the Bible, we share together the consolidation of these
in the apostles'
creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord. He was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. If you can remain standing, we'll continue with prayer. Let us pray. O Lord, we do pray that you would continue to work your Holy Spirit in us, directing us according to your will, turning up the flame, so to speak, that we would receive your comfort in our difficult times, that you would help us to be comforting and caring for others through their times of struggles. Help us to remain steadfast in faith. Help us to increase love in action. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Lord Jesus Christ, you call and send your people as witnesses throughout this world, in every time, every place, to all kinds of people, whatever colors they might be, whatever cities, towns, countries, villages they may be from the lowly to the mighty, from the rich and wealthy to the very poorest. Help us to be ones who also carry this loving invitation to a relationship with Jesus, and share it with our neighbors, our friends, our family. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Lord, there have been tragedies all around us. There have been tragedies in this world. Lord, we pray. Around our country, in recent weeks, there have been great tragedies. Gun violence. There have been tragedies even as close as Ames. Lord, we pray for all those suffering, struggling, trying to make sense where we cannot make sense of why evil works its ways in such horrible ways to destroy lives and hurt others. Lord, we pray for ways to bring control, yet also allow freedoms. But Lord, we pray for those who are surviving and dealing with such sadness in their hearts and such pain. We pray for the families of those who have lost loved ones. We pray, Lord, that we can be comforting to them. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
O Lord, we look around us and we give thanks, O Lord, for the spring and the summer, for the seed and for the soil, for the great sun shining and the great showers of rain, for farms and farmers and gardeners, and those who grow beautiful flowers for us to see. All of this is life and growth from your hand. O Lord, you have given us this earth to take care of as your faithful stewards and caretakers. It is not belonging to us. It is always yours. But help us to do our duty and jobs as stewards of your great bounty of creation. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Lord Jesus, you are the great physician. We take a few moments of silence now to pray for those who have illnesses, disease, injury, those who have depression, or those who have grief in their hearts over the loss of loved ones. We take some moments now to name the ones we are praying for in our hearts to you. Defend them in times of danger. Give them your peace and safety. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
O Lord, we thank you that you have taught us what you would have us to believe and to do on a daily basis. transformed by your holiness. Help us to receive your comfort in this life and even unto our death. And to that all God's people can say.
Amen.
I invite you to be seated now, and we'll continue with the offering. Stand and continue. Sisters and brothers, it is important to properly prepare and to understand Holy Communion. We shake together. Holy Communion is the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ, received in and under the earthly elements, instituted by Christ Himself. The benefit of Holy Communion is pointed out in Christ's words, given and shed for you, for the forgiveness of sins. Through these words, the forgiveness of sin, life, and salvation are given to us in the sacrament. For where there is forgiveness of sin, there is also reconciliation with God and with one another. Let us all come near to God and confess our sin and ask for forgiveness in the name of Jesus. The Lord is merciful and will keep His promise to forgive our sin. Let us pray. Gracious Lord, I confess my sins, known and unknown, and my decisions to not follow where you are leading me. I believe that without your mercy, I am lost. Please wash away all my sins. I ask for your forgiveness. Hear the good news. Jesus forgives you. God sent Jesus to us, and His plan was fulfilled when Jesus died on the cross for all our sins, and then conquered death, giving those who believe in Him everlasting life. Jesus continues to call the unbelieving to turn to Him and repent and believe while there is still time. Amen to that. Our Lord Jesus Christ, on the night in which He was betrayed, took bread, gave thanks, and broke it, and gave it to His disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body, given for you. When you eat this, remember all that I've done for you." Again, after supper, He took the cup, gave thanks, and gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin." He said, "When you drink this, remember all that I've done for you." I invite us to pray together as Jesus taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, anyone, it's a good time to come up front for communion. We'll be here at the altar rail. If you're not able with mobility issues and you need to stay where you're seated, we'll come to commune you where you're seated as well.
Thank you.
Savior Jesus Christ strengthen you and keep you in his grace now and into everlasting life. Amen. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord's face shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord look upon you with his favor and give you his peace. In the name of the Father, and the Son,